Ever since we were little kids, we've been taught how to count. Something most of us are pretty good at, especially if you're going to be watching this video, you're probably pretty good at counting from 1 to 50 or even 100 if you're quite talented. The thing is all the counting that we do is in base 10, and that is because we have 10 fingers. At least that's what we think, and it makes sense to me. So we can say, hey, I want 10 things. Oh no, I want 20 things. I want 30 things. Something like that. And so that is how we count. No reason to mess with it. Except if you're going to be working with embedded systems, computers, anything like that, everything there is in binary. And then, for reasons that you may or may not understand, they're also in hexadecimal. So we're going to go over basically why base 10 is the way it is, decimal, the way we count currently, what base 2 is, what hexadecimal is, why we use it, and then you're going to understand not only how these all work together, but also how to convert from one to the other, and why hexadecimal is so darn cool. So first things first, let's talk about base 10 or decimal. So let's take a number. I'm going to randomly come up with a number, let's say 453. So 453. Now the interesting thing is if you look at it, the numbers that make up our numbers actually only range from 0 to 9. So there's only 10 actual numbers. Once we get up to 9, instead of coming up with another number, we'll just call it Bob for no reason, it's 0 to Bob, we go 10. So when you're looking at 453 right here, you're not actually looking at a single number, you're looking at 400 plus 50 plus 3. And that comes out to 453. And so basically what you have here is 0 to 9, you have here 10 to 90, and then you have here 100 to 900. And then you just change each one as you need to. Now, the way this is broken up is you basically look at it, and you can look at it top down to make it make more sense. And you just want to say, okay, 0 to 9, and then what am I doing? 10 to 90, 100 to 900. And then this keeps on going, 1,000 to 9,000. And you just throw in whatever numbers you want there to make what you want. So now I have 7,453. Hey, I want 87,000. And that's how it goes. So that is generally how our base 10 works. Now to make this more generic, let's do this as 10 to the 0, 10 to the 1, 10 to the 2, 10 to the 3, wow, that 10 got really ugly, and 10 to the 4. Now you'll notice that's the same. 10 to the 0, anything to the 0 is 1. So that multiplier is then multiplied by whatever number you have underneath. So that's 3 times 1. That's 5 times 10. That's 4 times 100. That's 7 times 1,000, 8 times 10,000, and that's how you get 87,453. So that is how our numbering system works. If you understand this, it's going to make understanding binary way easier. So this is base 10, and so that is 10 to the 0, 10 to the 1, 10 to the 2, 10 to the 3, which goes on for infinity, 10 to the 5. It's always incremented by 1, but it just goes on forever. Now, if we're going to do binary, which is base 2, it's going to be slightly different. Now, the reason we do base 2 is because it is what computers can think in. They can think 0, 1, and that's all they can think in. They can't think maybe, I don't know, stuff like that. It's always yes or no, and so that is why they use binary or base 2. Now, let's look at base 2. So instead of being 10 to the 0, 10 to the 1, we have 2 to the 0, 2 to the 1, 2 to the 2, 2 to the 3, 2 to the 4, 2 to the 5, etc. And you have to go out farther because you can't get as many values in each slot. Instead of going from 0 to 9, you can either say 0 or 1. So these are our multipliers, and then we can either choose that they are 0 or 1. So I am going to randomly put some numbers in here, and I'm going to say 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. Now, 2 to the 0 is going to give me basically 1, 2 to the 1 is 2, 2 to the 2, 4, 8, 16, 32. Let's just throw in another one there. Oh, that's gonna be a big number. So now if I wanna look at this from a decimal, the way our brain works viewpoint, I can look at this and say 1 times 1 is 1, 1 times 2 is 2, 0 times 4 is 0, 1 times 8 is 8, 1 times 16 is 16, 1 times 32 is 32. And then I can just simply add those together, which, please don't make me do math in my head, is, oops, I forgot the one, is going to be 40, 56, 58, 59. Hopefully that is right. Let me pull up, I didn't pull this up before, I need to pull this up really quick. We actually have a binary to hexadecimal converter on circuitbread.com, and I wanna double check all my stuff before I make any assertions. And this is also down in the description if you want to jump on here and check it out. It actually can convert anything from base 2 up to base 26 is I think how we set it up. So let me, 111011. Is 59. Okay, excellent. I did it right. It's something I feel pretty comfortable with it, but I do make a lot of arithmetic mistakes, as well as I say the wrong words a lot, as you've probably noticed if you've watched any of my videos. So this is the way that we can take a binary number and change it to a decimal number. And that's super helpful, but we also need to be able to take a decimal number and turn it into a binary number. Now, I'm just going through paper like crazy here. Let's go the opposite direction. I'm going to come up with a random number, so 43. Now we know that 43 is less than 64, so we know that it's gonna be less than 2 to the 6. So 2 to the 5, 2 to the 4, 2 to the 3, 2 to the 2, 2 to the 1, 2 to the 0, and if I haven't, I should apologize for my handwriting again. It is horrendous. So, again, knowing this is 64, 32, et cetera, et cetera. The way we go the other direction is you say, okay, 43, it's less than 64, so I'm gonna put a 0 there. But 43 is bigger than 32, so I'm gonna put a 1 there, and then I'm gonna subtract 32, which gives me 11. Now, I know that 11 is smaller than 16, so I'm gonna put a 0 there. But it's bigger than 8, so I'm gonna put a 1 there, subtract it, minus 8 gives you 3. So 2 to the 2 is 4, which is going to give me another 0. 2 to the 1 is 2, which gives me a 1, minus 2. And then 2 to the 0, which is 1, is going to give me another 1. So 43 is 0101011. Now, I would like to do a video later where we go through a couple more of these because I know I'm going pretty fast, but right now I just want to focus on the concept. So when we were going from binary to decimal, we simply found out what each one of those were and we added them together. So 0 times 4 was 0 and everything else, just do some simple addition. And then going from decimal to binary, you have to do a little bit more intuitive thinking of, okay, that first number is, what is it smaller than? And you'd have to know exactly where to start on your binary side. But once you figure out, okay, 43 is less than 64, I can start right there and then just go through down the line and subtract it. Now this is very time intensive and you'll never do this in real life. There's no reason for you to do this in real life. The only reason you should be doing this is to get a good understanding of what's going on. And once you have an intuitive understanding, one, you'll be able to do some of the smaller stuff in your head quite easily. And two, you'll be better prepared so that when you go and use a converter, you type it in and you can do that quick. Does that make sense? Did I do that right? Yes, everything's great, but you're never gonna be doing this in real life. There's no reason, but understanding the concept is crucial. So now we've talked about decimal and binary and have gone from decimal to binary, binary to decimal. What is hexadecimal all about? Hexadecimal is beneficial because this is 2 to the 6 and you're getting 7 digits right there. Now we have 64-bit computers, which means that you have 64 ones and zeros. And I don't know about you, but I can't keep that many ones and zeros straight in my head. Honestly, even with hexadecimal, it's still difficult. But what hexadecimal does is it simplifies things and it makes what seems like a bunch of just random ones and zeros into something that's a little bit more human readable. And because of that, a lot of compilers, when you're doing embedded systems like with Microchip, Atmel, now they're the same, I guess, Renesas, wow, I don't know why I'm listing all of these, STM, NXP, whatever. Most of them do their IDEs so that it naturally, the number you put in is hexadecimal versus decimal, which can really screw you up. So let's go over hexadecimal really quick. Hexadecimal is base 16. So we were doing 10 to the 0, 10 to the 1, and then 2 to the 0, 2 to the 1. Now we're doing 16. 16 to the 0, 16 to the 1, 16 to the 2, 16 to the 3. And frankly, I can't do this sort of math in my head. So that comes out to be 0 to 16. And then this is... Oh, wow, okay, I'm really throwing myself off here. I have to admit that hexadecimal is harder for me to do in this because the numbers are so much bigger and I can no longer do the math in my head. So I'm going to do some quick cheating. 16 times 16 is 256. Oh, I should have known that. And then do another 16 in there is 4096. So you can see this gets big very, very, very fast. And the basic concept is the same, that whatever is in each of these slots is then multiplied by whatever is up here, which in this case is 1, this case is 16, 256, 4096. Now the challenge here is that, like I said before, I called 10, the what would come after 9, I called it Bob just because that's kind of the random name I give anything. But in reality, we need actual numbers to represent 10, 11, 12, 13, and 14, because again, it's 0 to 15 to give us our 16 digits. Now, because most of us know the ABCs, they just decided that would be a very simple way to represent the additional numbers. So instead of 0 to 9, it's 0 to F. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, A, B, C, D, E, F. And F is equivalent to 15. So if I put F here, that's F times 1, and so that's 15 times 1, which equals 15. But then if I put over here 16, if I put F, that's F times 16, which is going to be 16 less than 256. So what is that, 240? Oh, I really hate doing math on camera. I get very self-conscious and certain that I'm going to destroy things. So 15 times 16, 240. Whew, yes. Actually, one of the biggest challenges here is when you don't see Fs, when you don't see the letters. That's when people screw up. So sometimes you'll see something where you're doing your numbers and you'll see somebody write 33 right there. So you think, oh, 33, sweet, I know that, that's 33. But in reality, that's 3 times 16 plus 3, which is a vastly different number than 33. So one of the things that they do to make it easier, and unfortunately sometimes it just defaults to hexadecimal, which is again what happens in a lot of the IDEs out there. But if you want to say, no, I want this to be decimal or binary, or explicitly state that it's hexadecimal, you usually put an H, B, or a D, depending on what you have. So for here, you'd have 33H to show that that's 33 hexadecimal. Now, if you wanted that to be decimal, you'd do 33D. And then binary, you can't do 33, but you'd at least have 1010B to make sure people don't think that's 1010. Now, you'll also see hexadecimal written out as 0x0033, or just 0x33. So 0x or 33H, that's two different ways of showing hexadecimal, but both of them work, and you'll see them so much that once you see this, you'll see it all over the place, you won't think twice about it. Now, the question is, why does this matter? Why do we have hexadecimal when this just seems so random, and it is kind of a pain to convert it from decimal to hexadecimal? That's because you don't typically convert from decimal to hexadecimal. You typically do your conversions between hexadecimal and binary, which is incredibly easy. So let me grab another piece of paper. So one of the beautiful things about binary and hexadecimal is binary, you go 2 to the 0, 2 to the 1, 2 to the 2, 2 to the 3, and that gives you 8, 4, 2, 1 as your multipliers. And so this range, this subset right here, can give you any value between 0 and 15, which is exactly what one character in hexadecimal can do. So the way this is so easy is that instead of, I'm just going to write a bunch of random ones and zeros, and da, ba, da, 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 da. Hopefully those are super random. And notice how I gave them a little space between each one, because now I can take each one of these and turn them into a very simple hexadecimal value that is then very easily shown. And so instead of having to remember 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, remember numbers. So give me a second, I'm going to calculate these out, hopefully not embarrass myself too bad. This looks like it's 12, which would make this 13, which would make this 7, which makes this 11. So in hexadecimal, this would be A, B, C, D, B, 7. So I could write all of this crazy stuff, which I'm already gonna forget, and then I can just look at this, B7DC. It sticks with your mind so much better, it's so much easier, much more compact, and that is why hexadecimal is such a big thing. And again, doing the conversion from hexadecimal to decimal, it's not a big deal. You don't do this stuff manually, you use converters, so if you even need to do it, it's pretty simple, straightforward. There's no reason you should have to do it manually. However, going from binary to hexadecimal is so simple that you can very, very easily do it by hand, and it's very intuitive, and it just makes things a lot better for embedded systems. So that's it. Hopefully that explains not only why we need to worry about binary and hexadecimal, but it also explains our own numbering system of base 10 decimal system and how we can move between all of them seamlessly, flawlessly, and easily. If you have any questions, leave them in the comments below or go to circuitbread.com and put a comment there or read our write up there. If you like this video, give it a like, subscribe to our channel, and we'll catch you on the next tutorial.